Yeah, guys. Well, I'm really excited to be with you here today. Of course, my name is Scott Royal Smith. I'm with Royal Legal Solutions. We're an asset protection company exclusively developed to be able to help real estate investors. I've been a real estate investor for over 8 years now, and I'm also an attorney. My exclusive work in life is to protect real estate investors. We work with real estate investors all over the United States in every asset class. I'm personally invested in over 10 different states right now. And the last time we just did our count here, we have about $1.2 billion in assets underneath our advisement right now for protection purposes.
Wow, great. That's awesome.
Yeah, man, it's been a journey getting up here, but we're really excited about, you know, where we're at right now. One of the key things that people, you know, don't really realize when they get into real estate is that real estate itself is inherently risky, but in different kinds of ways. You know, it's really great with having the consistent the cash flows and as well as the ability to generate that massive income. But one of the things you know is that you end up running into is that you can own assets in your personal name a lot of the times and not realize you're totally exposed. And this is really from, you know, one of the key pieces from litigation. A lot of people think mistakenly that their insurance is there and is sufficient to protect them. But the reality is that insurance, you know, only covers this one type of legal claim called negligence and doesn't cover, you know, any of the other types of legal pieces like breach of contract or an allegation of fraud. And I've personally seen people that have got wiped out for over $3 million in real estate. Because they had assets in their personal name and they thought it was sufficient and that their insurance would protect them, and it didn't. I mean, a simple car accident had some catastrophic injuries with it, and then bam, the guy ends up losing, you know, $3 million in real estate. Now he's a client of RLS, and we've helped him rebuild and protect himself appropriately, but that's a rough pill to swallow.
Mm-hmm. Good for him getting back in the game and not giving up.
Yeah, you know, you really have to. I think like that's one of the pieces that we see really a lot on the Real Estate Nerds podcast is, you know, time and time again, the real estate investors that really make it and do really big are the guys that can, you know, take a licking and they go back to their roots of saying, you know, how did I become successful in the very beginning, getting their mindset right, and then taking the right next steps that they need to be able to build and build appropriately. You know, that's a really expensive lesson that I hope that I never have to learn and nobody else that I interact with ever has to learn. Because losing $3 million and coming back is a messy thing to do, you know, in life. So, but
Scott,
we don't
I want
have to
say one thing.
That.
This is your show and I'm going to shut up now. I have a hard time keeping my mouth. But guys, it's so much of it's up here. So much of the game is won up here. And Scott just brought up such a good point because it's a tough game, especially in the beginning. You're going to take some gut shots before you figure out your systems and how to deal with these different things that come up. So much of the game is one upstairs. Just keep that in mind. Scott, I'm going quiet.
And I want to give one. No, I want to give
keep
one.
Keep on jumping in, guys. This is
yeah,
great.
No, I want to give one plug to Scott. What I think Scott should do is he should actually do a case study and maybe get that guy on a podcast. I don't know if he wants to share a story, but that's what people need to hear.
You're powerful.
People need to hear they're not the only ones making these stupid mistakes. And they're stupid mistakes. That doesn't mean you're a stupid person. Smart people do dumb things and dumb people do smart things. Doesn't mean you're dumb or you're smart. It's just you were in that state at that time and maybe you're a little bit cheap or you're just a little ignorant. You didn't know about the
key
fact.
Is to learn from it though, right, Gino? You got to learn from that stuff.
And my father used to say, if you make a mistake once, it's on you. If you make a mistake the second time, you're an idiot, right? So you don't want to lose $3 million two times. Losing it once is bad enough, but you know, losing it twice, I don't know. I mean, that's something that you can really take care of. But you have to know the right people. You have to be in business and figure out what did I do wrong. So I think, Scott, if you can get him on your podcast, that would be a really awesome podcast for you to have.
Oh. Yeah, absolutely, man. I'm going to work on that. Not everybody is super happy to share their, you know, kind of like their worst deals, like their biggest mistakes they made in life. But but it's the ones we all learn from the most, right? And so that's why yeah. We have the Real Estate Nerds podcast is because it's a way for everybody to air out dirty laundry, to be like, hey, don't make these mistakes. And this is where you can kind of start feeling out things that are going like really well and how you can know when things are going really well and know when things are going really wrong, but from other people's stories. And you know, I had Rod Cleef on the show and he shared a story about how he lost $50 million because of the way that he was holding real estate at one time. And then, you know, markets turned and then boom, you know, he went from living inside of the mansion across the bay to a condo across the bay inside of a year, you know, and being pretty much bankrupt. So, yeah, so great lessons all around here. That's going to be dropping September 1st, guys. So, that'll be a cool way to be able to plug into that. And I'm going to get that, I'm going to get him on the, I'm going to get that other guy on the podcast here that my friend that lost $3 million. when he thought insurance was enough. So it really comes down to, you know, for a lot of these guys, when you're talking about lawsuits, is that real estate is one of those assets, you know, that if you have like private stocks or money, maybe people don't know how much you have, right? But in real estate, it's all part of the public record. So people can start to see really easily where the money is. And what that allows attorneys to do is to be able to do some research and find out whether you're a good target for them to come after. Right. And that's actually what the business of lawsuits is really about. It's about attorneys trying to make money. And we, you know, we see that all the time, right? From like TV and radio and all over the place, that like attorneys are trying to find people to sue so they can get the money. And unfortunately, real estate investors are in a really bad position because they know where the money's at and they know that you can't hide it because there's nothing you can do, you know, in terms of being able to hide a house, right? Like you can with trying to hide your stocks or something. You know, it's one of those pieces of what asset protection, I think, at the end of the day is really about. It's about trying to, all of us trying to have more peace in our lives and be able to live a better life. And fundamentally, what that comes down to is really saying, like, am I really, is my financial freedom that I'm trying to create for myself to either like leave my job, supplement in my income, or be able to retire, really in a place where I know that whatever happens, I'm going to be okay. Right? Because what the reality situation is most people, you know, forego that thinking, hey, you know, nothing bad is really going to happen to me. I'm a really nice, honest, good person, not knowing that really nice, honest, good people get sued all the time. And then once they're inside of the litigation, they realize like, oh, this is actually a rigged game. That's not about justice. It's really about like, how do you use leverage and, you know, malign people's names to be able to make them look horrible. So that way you can, you know, bully them into having to pay.
Sounds like politics.
Yeah, it really is, man, because like really the way it lines up is like your job as a litigator. And this is why I got out of doing that, because I was suing, you know, huge insurance companies for a couple of years before I started doing asset protection for real estate investors full time. And the whole game is like, what's every fact and what way can I twist it to make somebody else look horrible? You know, and so you can be like a good, honest, nice person. And after that gets put through the wash of an attorney looking at the facts of the situation, you would have think that you like you smothered Mother Teresa in her sleep or something, you know?
Like, that's soul sucking, bro. That's a soul sucking job.
Man. But that's the reality, right? But like what we're trying to do here is we're trying to set up people and, you know, you guys and everybody with the ability to be able to say, you know, even if like I get a major lawsuit threatened against me, like I can just totally not care. My life doesn't stop, even if a lawsuit happens, because I know I'm going to lose little to nothing. So it's not even a worry. I'm not even threatened by what would normally be something like a soul crushing event. I mean, if you talk to anybody who gets sued, it's always the same. Oh, worst experience in my life. Like hands down every single time. Same story. And so the one of the reasons I think that like a lot of people haven't decided to take action on getting protected, right, is because everybody says, yeah, I'd like to be protected, but the other piece of it too is, says, holy smokes, like what's that going to cost, right? And you would find, and from the research that I was doing up to 4 years ago that still exists even today, I mean, you're finding the average, you know, firms that are setting these things up are like $7,000 to $15,000, and then once you start looking at some of these more sophisticated pieces, up to $25,000 plus, right? So it really became something that was only for the really affluent investors and the really wealthy people to be able to take advantage of, because for everybody else, it's like, man, that's some money I'd rather have, you know, to be able to live on or to invest. And that's where we kind of stepped in, as we said, wow, that's not good. You know, I sat there and I said, well, this is really bogus, man. Like everybody should be able to put together something that can protect themselves. And that's what started me down the journey of investigating like what that would be. You know, I was reading every book, contacting every professional, you know, trying to put together the first system of asset protection for some clients, you know, 4 years ago. And that's what led, you know, into Royal Legal Solutions coming into existence, was finding out that, oh man, there's a whole field out here where we can do things that are much more efficient, that work just as well, and that the average investor can take advantage of. And so what this webinar is really going to be about, guys, it's going to be showing you exactly what it is that you need to be doing to use the best strategies that are available, that are efficient from a cost perspective, but also give you high levels of protection from the assets themselves, as with using a series LLC structure, and being able to hold the assets and your company itself completely anonymously from the public records. So that way, you know, if anybody ever looked to sue you, they wouldn't even know that you have anything at all. It looks like you qualify for food stamps, and so you're not a good target. And then if they even tried to sue you after that, their LLC structure and company structure steps in to protect you. That makes it where they actually don't get anything. So one, they're disincentivized from even doing anything in the first place. And then even if they do that step, they get a whole nother dose of bad news, which is they're not going to get anything, even if they try hard. And really, like, there's levels to this game. So no matter how big or how small you are, you can start somewhere, you know, and just start with the right foundation, guys. Like, if you can think through step 1 through 10, but know you're just taking step 1, then you're on the path to be able to create something that's great for yourself and great for your life. And that doesn't matter whether that's, you know, learning to play a sport, or like learning how to play a violin, or learning how to do real estate, or in this case today, we're talking about asset protection. One of the things that we're going to be talking about here today is going to be talking about the levels of this that you can walk up, and you can find out, like, what's a level that makes sense to you for your personal, you know, situation. You know, we can help you with that as well too, to help coach you through and talk you through what that actually look like, depending upon what you're trying to accomplish. And knowing that you can take a small step, knowing that you can always build on it later as you need to. So there's the bottom line about this is that this isn't really for the rich anymore. This is really for the common investor of like a whole piece of the puzzle that before has been really missed about like what are the best practices we need to be doing that previously it was only the rich and sophisticated and savvy, but now we can all do something out there. And this is really true because the new technology of using a series LLC structure for your asset holding that allows things to grow with you allows you to create things at a fraction of the price. And I know because, you know, using this strategy was something that I came up with. I mean, it wasn't new. All the tools were already there, right? All I've done is I've just assembled them in a way that's unique that nobody else is using right now that allows us to leverage our expenditures and what we're using with these company structures to maximize all of the benefits and to streamline all of the operations. Because there was one thing I set out when I was creating this is to say, one is that it has to save people a shit ton of money. Otherwise, it's not gonna fly. The other thing it can't do is it can't complicate people's lives. It has to actually simplify everybody's life, or it's not gonna be something that I wanted to do. So I was like, it has to be 10 times better as an actual service, and it also needs to be half the price. Otherwise, I'm not even going to spend my life trying to build this thing. And that's what we've created at Royal Legal Solutions. And that's why, you know, we're experiencing such massive growth as we've been sharing it, you know, on podcasting and other media platforms. And this is the Royal Legal Solutions. You know, you can see right here, even our logo is built like a castle, because that's what we're always about. I mean, we're talking about the castles of protection that scare away people from wanting to ever even think about trying to raid those assets of yours. So the number one benefit that we can see from protecting assets is that it's really about it's protecting your equity as well as any of the funding you've gained from your properties. And this is really about like trying to create like what's the dream, your dream out here, right? Like everybody's dream is not really to own real estate. Like our dreams are about being able to create better things with our lives, whatever those are going to be, whether that's being able to leave like a piece of pain in your life, maybe that's your job or whatever that might be, and to explore something new and different for you. And all of those pieces come down essentially to saying like, I need resources, and we're going to call that resource money to be able to go do that. And so the benefit that we have here is saying like, if we can protect all of your resources, protect all of your money for you, then now your dreams have now become solidified, and it's much easier to take that step into, you know, where does that dream life lead me? And a lot of this has to end up dealing with our benefit number two, which is, you know, it's about a lifestyle that you want to protect, right? When we talk about things, you know, whether it's going to be your retirement or your family or your future or your trips, whatever that's going to be, all of those come down to say, like, what is the life that I want to be living? Am I clear on what that is? And then the second piece is saying, okay, well, now that I'm clear on it, do I have the money to have it? Great. And then the third piece is saying is like, how long can I sustain that? So real estate's one of those amazing things because it has the passive income that can come through. Sometimes you'll hear people refer to that as horizontal income. It has this great passive income. But the question that becomes is like, how sustainable is it? Well, passive income gives you sustainability of a lifestyle, but not if it can be threatened. Right. And that's why we have to take these other small measures to put in place that give us massive protection to really solidify our future and to know that people can't affect our lifestyle. Even in the worst case scenario of things happening to us, you don't get to mess with my lifestyle. The most you get to be is like a fly of a nuisance in my life, but you don't get to really affect me. And the top benefit number three is all of these asset protection strategies have to come and to be in a place where they're going to be affordable. For investors to take advantage of them, right? There's no sense in buying more protection than you need, or having to take on, you know, debt to be able to protect something, right? So what we're really doing is trying to set up like a no-brainer type of decision that says everybody in the world can come in here. We can put you in a system, you know, that you've chosen to be able to grow your real estate portfolio infinitely without incurring additional overhead expenses, as well as operational headaches, et cetera. And all of this really comes down to, at the end of the day, it's like these guys here, you know, it's real estate litigators, you know, these guys are specialists in the field of being able to come after, you know, pieces of property and come after the unsuspecting and the unprepared at the moment you pop up on the radar. The end of the day, if you get to know litigators, right, it's really like they don't even really care who you are, right? The only thing they care about is can they get paid at it, because they're all get paid on commission. So all of these guys are actually, like, in a way, just hired sharks waiting for somebody to come into the door that can get up on a stand and testify that they were hurt, so that way they can get money out of it, right? Like, it's not too far off on like how Saul Goodman used to work, right? Off of, I don't know if you got anybody's ever seen that show, but it's really not that, right? Far off. Yeah, right. Yeah, it's Better Call Saul, right?
You know, the funny thing is, this is actually very similar to Gino and my first headshot that we did for the podcast. That's the funny thing about the picture here. So,
yeah. You guys look that slick. That's awesome. It's just some slick killers on the right. You guys too. You guys just slayed in a different scenario, you know, which is rad. The main part about that too is what we have to do then is we have to attack those sharks back with like having better defensive measures. And the way that we do that is we set up an asset protection company in place, because that creates a stopgap that says, you know, even in my worst case scenario, maybe I lose 5%, you know, maybe I lose that one property that's out there, right? But I'm not going to lose all my other properties. I'm not going to lose my personal bank accounts or my stocks or anything else that I've going on. You know, we always hope that insurance is going to step in to protect us. And that's going to be work for us about 80% of the time. But there's another 20% of the time where insurance doesn't protect us, where they say it's not included or it's not covered, or, you know, that they deny coverage because it's too expensive, right? And we've all seen those news stories, haven't we? Like all over the news and all the time is when insurance says, no, we're not going to pay because it was expensive. So, but that happens to individuals all the time too, right? If you have grandma that falls through the staircase, you know, the rotten staircase in one of your properties or something, all of a sudden the insurance company is going to say, whoa, 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 you should have known about that rotten staircase, so we're not going to cover it. And so, you know, grandma gets to sue you personally for everything. And, you know, come to find out that she's now permanently disabled. And, you know, now it's this huge bill that comes.
Scott, I think
right?
You said it before, too. The lower the claim, the more apt they are to pay it. But the higher it gets up there, the real serious ones are the ones they're going to try to punt on. So if it's a little one, a couple hundred, you know, or a couple thousand bucks or whatever, they're more likely to pay those ones, correct?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah. So the insurance will always step in to pay the little tiny claims, like almost always, right? Because it's barely worth the time of even having to, you know, get anybody involved, because it's a business on their end, right? It costs them money to actually even process the claims. So on really small claims, they're always going to take those. And the bigger the claim gets, the more likely they are to find a way to deny it. And the really big claims, they almost always deny, like leaving you having to sue your own insurance company.
At least on the first pass through, right? Like they'll just deny the first one to see if it sticks, and then you have to go fight for it, right?
Yeah, and you have to fight for it, and eventually you might leave yourself having to sue your own insurance company with the deep pockets that you thought were supposed to be protecting you, right? Yep. So it really, you know, it's very unsavory in a lot of ways because lawsuits are extremely expensive. You're typically talking about to be able to sue your insurance company and have any type of shot at it, you're probably needing to coming out with like $25,000 to $30,000 out of pocket exactly at a minimum. Right. So who among us is prepared to do that when you're talking about like
Gino
that
is.
Would be like, yeah, well, Gino's got those fat backs. I don't think he even has a chair. He just has a pile of money.
So, he's spitting on him like he's rocking on the stacks right now. That's what it's like when he flushed like the G dad. All right.
That's why I'm in this call. I'm on this call to protect myself, bro, I guess. Right.
Yeah. You gotta, man, protect them stacks, man.
Yeah, that's it. He's just going to Scrooge McDuck all over the afternoon. So, yeah, man, and that's really what it comes down to is a lot of you know how that game is played. But luckily, like we don't have to rely on insurance companies, right? We can use an asset protection strategy with a company structure that allows us to say like even if the insurance company totally screws me on this deal, like I'm losing super little, right? But I'm still gonna have insurance because insurance is gonna get rid of all those small nuisance claims for me and you know keep me from having to deal with all of that stuff that it really would be like. That I don't want to deal with and is actually not a good use of resources to deal with. So instead of like trying to bulk up on a ton of insurance, much better solution is, you know, get like a, you know, medium amount of insurance, a small to medium amount of insurance, and then invest in an asset holding company protection on that, because that's going to cover you when the insurance doesn't. And we know if it's a super big claim anyway, you're going to end up having to sue your own insurance company regardless. Right. So like, what's the point of getting some monster policy?
Can I ask a quick question about that?
Yeah.
Yeah, and this refers to umbrella policies, there's not a right or wrong. It's just your opinion on it. So you can get a $10 million umbrella for $8,000, right? $8,000 for a $10 million umbrella to cover. And this is beyond your normal insurance policy, or you can get a $250 million umbrella for like $16,000 because they know it's never going to get cranked up that high. So you know, at what point do you say, okay? I'm going to spend the $16,000 for the serious policy, or do you just save the $8,000 and get the $10 million umbrella?
Yeah, what I would do is save that $8,000 and then either like invest that inside of a company structure that you know is going to protect you, that you don't have to rely on the insurance.
Well, say you already have the company structure set up.
Yeah, or take that $8,000 and put it in the bank, man. And then just save that as like a discretionary fund, because if you actually have a war chest of money behind you and capital that you can throw at something if something bad happens, that's really how stuff gets handled. Like in the United States, lawsuits get won or lost based upon money, right? Like all of these asset protection pieces we're putting into place give you this incredible amount of leverage in a machine. It's like kind of like rolling into like warfare and where people are playing with BB guns and you're driving a tank, right? But at the end of the day, you still got to have gas for the tank to make it run, right? And so when you have like a fat stack of cash to be able to throw at something that's going to cause you a problem like that, that's much better than an insurance, you know,
so you take a $10 million umbrella and $8,000 in the bank every year as a CapEx reserve, blow these mofos up account versus the $250 million umbrella.
Oh, absolutely. All day. Yeah.
I like it.
Yeah, man. Because like, because at the end of the day, it's all going to come down to a lawsuit, right? Into it. And then and my best case scenario is what? Like, I'm hoping my insurance company wants to pay off this monster claim. Like, no way. I'd rather much rather have the control on my side of it and have a war chest to be able to control like what's my tactical options at that point instead of having an insurance company like make all those decisions for me.
I wish we could just buy weapons instead, like real weapons with it.
Dude, but hey, seriously, two swords, put me in a room with the guy, and that would be really like when attorneys would really earn their fees if you really had to fight the other guy to the death.
Yeah, man, and then a few of them, if more of them, you know, you kill a few here and there, it's probably not a bad thing, right?
Yeah,
no offense, Scott, we like you, right? But I'm just saying.
Seriously, I would never lose anyway, man. I got my background in like jiu-jitsu and kickboxing or whatever. Like, I would welcome this. This would be a very profitable.
Get it
like,
done with quick, man.
Yeah. So send in your champions and let's just have it out. And it's nice and clean and primal. I love it. So one of the things that we come into like around the asset protection piece that I was talking about earlier, you know, now that we have like a, you know, have an insurance that we need in place, got to have the insurance. Is that, you know, what we really needed at the time that we were originally looking at this, is that everybody's trying to set up individual LLCs for everything, but that requires them to do individual books, potentially have to do minutes for them. pay separate state fees, franchise taxes, registered agents, like all these other pieces. And what we were finding is that most of the people that we were talking to, nobody was actually doing it right. So what we decided is we really need to use the series structure, because that streamlines all of the actual work for everybody. So that way you don't end up having to do this massive amount of paperwork and upkeep every year, right, for all of these different companies. You only have to upkeep one company, but you get all of the protections as if you had individual smaller companies. So that's my big awesome mug right there down in Austin, Texas, outside of our office building. Here on the east side of Austin. That's at on Cesar Chavez over there, if anybody wants to swing by and say hello. We got me and 43 staff members currently at Royal Legal Solutions trying to help everybody. So we really do a lot of educational work here. As you can see, even on the right-hand side, I'm continually diagramming stuff out. I feel like that's mainly all I do all day long is talk and diagram for people that pop into the office. To be able to explain to them, how does these types of systems work together? One of the major pieces that I hear time and time again about the Series LLC is around what do we do with the Series LLC, because there's not a lot of case law out there about it. In fact, there's none. Nobody's even tried to challenge it over the last 20 years. Some people say that, it's not safe because there's no case law about it. And I take a little bit different of an approach. I look at it and say, well, it's been around for 20 years and it's been involved in thousands of court cases, right? And among those court cases, none of the people that would have got paid out huge if they could attack it tried to attack it. So what that means is actually really safe. And the reality is that you can only attack something and create what they call case law about it is when the law itself isn't clear. So in the case of the Series LLC, the law itself is very clear. So there's nothing to attack because there's a case law can only interpret what the law is. So when you have clear laws, there's nothing to interpret. So nobody's going to spend the $50,000-$60,000 to take a case up on appeal when there's no chance of winning. So I would say that that's actually a piece of strength that just a lot of people don't understand about how the law actually works. The law is what the statutes are. The law isn't case law when it comes to what the actual protections are. when we really look at what asset protection is bringing to the table here, we're really talking about is the financial security of what we're doing something that can we afford to play a game with, of saying am I willing to play a game of chance, of how things are going to play out. We know that there's a 95% probability of a real estate investor being involved in a major lawsuit during a 20-year period, right? Which is just about usually the average investing life for most people. The question becomes is when is that lawsuit going to happen? And the answer is we don't know. We don't know when that lawsuit's going to happen, but we know statistically it's going to happen. And the question that we have to ask ourselves at that point is saying, what position do I want to be in when the unexpected lawsuit springs up? Do I want to be in the position I am now, or do I want to be in a different position, in a more proactive position of strength? Or do I just want to kind of take things as they come and hope they're going to be okay? Because, some people will be okay, right? Maybe they only invest for a really short amount of time and they miss that, or, they're just one of the lucky few. But I don't know who that's going to be. And I don't think really any of us are, because lawsuits really are predicated upon the fact of other people getting pissed off and then wanting to sue us. And it doesn't matter how reasonable and how smart and how honest we are, because we, no matter how reasonable, smart and honest we are, those other people can still be getting pissed off. Right. So, if there's no real, safety in saying that I'm just going to be awesome as a person and somehow that's going to protect me.
Well, the chances are it's going to happen. I got sued at the restaurant. Somebody fell in the parking lot. They stepped over a bump and she fell. It was the most ridiculous lawsuit ever. We ended up paying the insurance company, ended up settling for $15,000. She shouldn't have gotten anything, But that's just the way insurance companies are, because she said she got hurt. We actually called the ambulance. They came to pick her up. Nothing really wrong with her. She sprained her ankle, but she's an older lady. She fell because she was clumsy and she's old. It did not, nothing structurally wrong with the
park. That should have been a cheeky parm and out the door, right?
Dude, man. I mean, it was the saddest thing. And that's why you got to have cameras, right? At the time, this happened like 10 years ago before our fire insurance claim. And I didn't have cameras. I wish I did. That's one of the reasons I think everyone should have cameras. And we've been sued at the properties. We had sued for bed bugs. We got sued by an employee. I mean, it's going to happen. It will happen. That's just the reality of it. So I totally agree. Everything you've been set up till now, 95% is probably 99%. And in 20 years, I mean, I don't know. Jake and I started. We got sued like 6 months after we started. It was the funniest thing. I mean, just looking back at it now, it's like, dude, he sued us for bed bugs. It was his freaking furniture. And he was suing us. And he's the biggest dirtbag there wasn't a plan. He was the dirtiest guy, and he's suing us for his own problem. But you know how we didn't know what we were doing. It's scary when it happens, and you lean in, you learn about it, but you have to protect yourself. So we're here to tell you that it's not a bad thing. It's just something that's going to happen, and if you're not prepared for it, or you're not at least cognizant of the fact that it's going to happen, because it always happens to real estate guys. We're always the rich guys. Everyone thinks you're the rich guy who has money, so you're gonna have a target on your back.
So Scott, absolutely. You said 20 years the average. Is that just because people, and you may not know the data, but is it because people start investing in their like 40s and 50s, or you said the average?
It's over a 20-year period, right? And that's when we capture the data to look at the statistics, as nationwide statistics. That's where we said, okay, well, over this period, you have a 95% chance, right? Over a 10-year period, you have a much smaller, you know, chance of being, and over 5 year, it gets smaller and smaller, right?
But saying the average life cycle of investors is about 20 years. Is that what I heard?
I think that's about right. Yeah, I think it's about right that you have like 20 per. It's about 20 years or so of most people that are getting into it. Gotcha. You know, because some people stay like for their full life, some people are only in it for like 5 years or so, right? So what they're doing, but it's really, you know, one of like the key pieces about this, right, is that when you have an asset holding company in place, it's that you actually don't have to be nearly as good as you think you have to be, right? So Gina, that's one of the key pieces about, you know, looking at the scenario you're in. You're saying, well, we don't know a lot of things. We're just kind of getting into it. We're not really quite sure about all the ins and outs of how everything's going to go. And maybe we get sued for this. Am I really liable for that or whatever, right? Like having that type of stopgap of what the threat is that's coming after you lets you be able to say like, well, maybe I don't actually have to know 1,000% about everything to be able to take action on that real estate deal, because I know my downside risk is only going to be X. You know, it's not catastrophic. I lose everything if something goes wrong, which is what people, when they own assets in their personal name, are actually doing. They're actually willing to say, like, I'm willing to take a gamble on every deal that I do, that you could have a catastrophic event happen that could come out of nowhere that you might not even be responsible for, but somehow you end up being legally liable for, right? And maybe it doesn't even make any sense. And so I choose to put myself in a position to be able to say that that no matter like what happens, I'm going to be okay. And maybe I don't have to be 1,000% sure on everything, because, you know, I'm capping my downside risk by having this company structure in place. And that really makes sense too when you think about it as, you know, what can happen in stock market crashes, right? And one of the reasons that we love real estate is because we love the consistency over time that it's able to give us, right? Even like the markets, you know, might take a beating, you know, we could see here in the future, right? But, you know, like we're probably still going to cash flow because people still have to have a place to live, right? So that's really different from a stock market crash. And similarly to what could happen in real estate, is a lawsuit is very much like a crash that would happen. Except in our case, by having, you know, company structure in place, like we get to set ourselves up to say we're not going to expose ourselves to being able to have a crash by not being protected. Yeah. So, and this is really what I was just getting at, you know, earlier. It's just really about like that 95% statistic from internal survey. It's really such a powerful piece. And it's really something that we have to take proactive measures on. It's very much like asking yourself, like, if I lived in a flood zone, would I buy flood insurance? Like, yes, absolutely. The banks are going to make you do it too, because they're going to say that's a smart investment. You know, do I have to buy fire insurance? Yeah, bank's going to make you buy that too, because it protects the investment. Well, do you have to buy asset protection? You know, does the bank make you do that? No. Why? Because the bank will get paid out regardless of whether the property gets foreclosed on or not, because of their lien position in the property. They don't really care about you and your investment. This is something to be able to do it that you have to take action on. And I know it's so sad, right? It's like that they don't really care about you.
They love
this. Yeah, they love
your money every month.
Long as you keep making the money every month, otherwise they come in and steal all your shit. Right, your personal guarantee, they foreclose on your property and start coming after you personally. I mean, that's what the personal guarantee on a note is. And this is like, that's a whole another piece to it, right? It's like, if by using asset holding companies correctly, you can even prevent banks from being able to come after you, because you, at the end of like this process, it's very, you know, very straightforward process. You're actually to make it where, you know, Jake and Gino don't own anything anymore. Right? They own companies that own things, but the bank could come after them all day long and they could care less, because it's like, well, you know, I got nothing here you can take because I don't actually own anything. My companies do, but you have no right to be able to come after the company.
I got a laptop and I got some pistols. That's it, man.
Yeah. And I got some whiskey and some guns. Come and take it.
That's it. Whiskey, guns, and a laptop, man. Bring it on.
He's ready to party.
I got some tequila too, just a little bit left.
Well, it is Monday, man. You know, otherwise it's gonna go to waste. And the reality is that we can't ever do things that make it where we're gonna guarantee that we're not gonna become part of a lawsuit. But what you can do is make it so that you're not a target. And even if you were somehow, you know, named in this lawsuit, you're going to be the person that they're going to say, like, well, we don't really want to fight to keep that person in. Because the number one thing that happens in a lawsuit is first of all, they name everybody, right? You try to sue everybody in the world whenever a lawsuit goes down if you're a plaintiff, because you're going to see who has money that I can go after. That's really what you're trying to figure out. And then there's another process, a part of that process that says everybody that just got named is going to try to get themselves dismissed from the lawsuit. And when you're fighting to get yourself dismissed from the lawsuit, you know, that's where all of these legal measures come into place to be able to make it where you have those legitimate legal arguments to get yourself removed from the lawsuit. And they're not going to fight to keep you in because it's going to look like you own nothing. Right. You know, they don't think they're going to get paid, so why would they spend a bunch of money and time to be able to do that? So, you know, your real estate investments are something that it's, you know, you acquire it and you have it in the palm of your hand, but like, how firmly do you really hold on to these assets? That way they can't be taken away from you. I mean, if you just listen to the Real Estate Nerds podcast that's coming up here, I mean, you're going to hear the stories. And I know that Jake and Gino, you know, also share the stories from their personal experience and whatnot about, you know, how deals can go sideways and what are all the ways that can do it. And this lawsuit piece of it is, you know, kind of like the third leg of the stool, you know. You have like the taxes that you need to have with like a CPA, and you have the deal finding piece of the stool. And then, you know, this third leg is what is the legal to make sure that I have consistent gains that are protected over time. And it doesn't take a whole lot of nerding out to be able to figure out what to do with your real estate investments and how they need to be structured. That's what Royal Legal Solutions does, is that we're a company that's just as much of an education company about helping people build better lives through real estate as we are anything else. A lot of these things here take a lot of education to be able to come up. I mean, it takes me about a year to personally train one of my staff to get up to speed to be able to answer questions at the level that I can. So we don't expect anybody coming in to be able to say, well, you have to know all of this before it's useful. Instead, what we do is say, listen, you need to know enough to know what's going on, right? So that way you can have a working understanding of how it is. But we take care of everything in-house for everybody. So that way you can go and do what you're best at, which is, you know, making your real estate investments. Or, you know, even if you're out of the game, it's really about that point. It's about like, how do you live your life better? And that's about being able to offload responsibilities onto other people that help take care of it for you. There's a good reason why you haven't heard of the system before. The reason is it's because, you know, people just haven't really gotten into the deep knowledge of it, right? It's a very much of a niche field. Series LLCs have been around for 20 years, right? You know, trusts have been around for hundreds of years. the combination of how do you mold those two together is something that only a handful of practitioners in the country, me being one of them, actually know how to use effectively for real estate investors. These types of entity structures are used in all different other types of industries, but it's just myself and a handful of other people that are really bringing it into the fold of, you know, the mainstream for as it applies to real estate, because that was my love. And that's what, you know, a little over 4.5 years ago, that's what I was tasked with doing, was to figure out what is the best system, you know, for some clients that I had out here in Austin. And that's what, you know, ended up becoming Develop. What you also will find if you speak to local attorneys, and you might even ask them this to see if they would even, you know, admit to it. But most attorneys are what they do is they learn one system or way of doing things that they will then try to like sell to everybody that comes to their door. And if it's not their system, they say it's not good, right? And they'll have some reason for saying it's not good, whatever that's going to be, right? And no matter how really true that is, because the fact of the matter, I think what happens is after attorneys go through law school, everybody decides they want to stop learning and stop really getting better at what they do. And now they're just kind of want to make money and do what they, you know, do what they know how to do, right? Because it's a lot of work to learn this stuff. I mean, it takes a significant amount of effort to do it. So, you know, we're changing the model, you know, one attorney at a time. We bring new attorneys in from, you know, different states all the time that come in that we train in our system. We essentially give all the secrets away to anybody that's willing to come and learn them from us, because we're about changing the industry as a whole more than we are trying to say, like, we have the super secret sauce and we're not willing to give it out to anybody. Yeah. So if you haven't, you know, met me before or listened to a podcast or webinar that I've done before, there's no way you would have heard about these types of strategies, I would think. They're just really very, very niche. And I can tell you that we have investors that come in that from people that have no properties, but they're looking for a way that they can scale and grow efficiently over time, all the way to people that have 500 properties. And the solutions that we're using are fundamentally the same for those people. There's some minor tweaks that you get once you start getting over 3 million in assets about how do you want to, I'm sorry, not in assets, but in equity of actual cash, and how you want to protect those. But no matter what level you're at, this is the same system that's going to work for you in the exact same ways. And so you can start with the end in mind and having a foundation for your growth as you go through. And so protecting your properties is one of the most important pieces that you do, with especially using the series LLC structure in combination with the anonymity trust. You're able to compartmentalize every asset as well as be able to hold them all anonymously, so that nobody is going to be able to identify exactly, you know, what is your assets before they try to come after it. And at the end of the day, you know, it's about, can we sleep well at night knowing that our futures are going to be protected and that we're going to be able to, you know, have that level of safety for our family and our financial future and even through retirement. You know, a lot of people say that like real estate investing, you know, and leaving their job is like, okay, yeah, that sounds great and beautiful, right? I don't really know how many of you guys have actually tried to do that before, but the moment that you leave your job, you've actually taken a very high risk type of step in your life, because the moment that you leave, your skills start becoming outdated and you start having gaps in your resume that start coming through, right? So when you're going to make that transition, it's awesome. It will change your life for an amazing way to be able to benefit you. But when you make that transition, you know, make it in the right way, so that way you can know that you're never going to be in a position of having to go back with your hat in your hand and being like, oh, okay, well, it didn't work out, you know. And there's really good ways of doing that by setting up proper foundations and, you know, meeting, you know, other great people that can help guide you through the process of how do you do and live that type of journey correctly. And you, because it's at the end of the day, it's about what is the freedom that we can explore and are we having the adventures with our friends and our families and life that we want to have. So, you know, when you're in a position that you have, you know, 95% guarantee of being involved in a major lawsuit in your lifetime, you know, what are the types of decisions that we really need to consider? Are we really going to think that our mere honesty who we are as a person is really going to be enough when we know that a legal system is essentially basically corrupt with people that are just trying to be scammy and come after money. And that's not just me. I mean, like, all you have to do is turn on the TV and you see that all the time. And, you know, I lived it to a large extent, and that's why I actually had to get out of it, because it's really like a soul crushing way of looking at when you realize, like, oh, you're as a litigator and these are plaintiff's attorneys coming in, your only job there is to extract money out of people. And so you're just tearing things down to be able to go do it. So for me, it wasn't for me, you know, like some people, you know, love it and they do it and they're great at it. And I'm sure that there's a lot of really good things and people that are doing that as doing great work with it. But in the business world, you know, once you see that lawsuits are a business, you realize it doesn't matter to anybody how honest you are, because they're just trying to get paid on their end of it, and they don't care about you, whether it hurts your family or anything. They don't know you, and they're happy just to take from you. It's really savage.
For me, when should people start thinking about this? Because I think Jake and I are already well into our career. We are already started. Don't you think that people should get on board with this even before they buy their first property, and at least have an end in mind, an exit strategy, how many assets they want to own and what the structure is? Shouldn't they contact you before they even start investing, or as they're starting down their journey?
Yeah. So what we like to do is we like to help people as soon as we can in their journey, right? Because we aren't a company that just set up all of the structural pieces. What we do as part of what we call as a family office membership to the firm is we have an unlimited amount and continuous amount of ongoing legal and real estate support for all of our members, all of our clients to it, right? So like, imagine this is that, you know, there's a certain amount that we pay, and we have some special discounts that we're offering to DA that are going to be promoted for you guys on a very limited basis. You know, some of these pieces are going to have a short window of time associated with them, with how long they're going to be available. And that'll all be part of the show notes of what we end up pushing out. But the key pieces to this is saying that, you know, we can help set up the foundations, right? From before you even have your first property, start with a proper foundation and with the end in mind of what it is you want to achieve. Then we can guide you through a system and say, what does that look like to get you from A to Z? Because it's not just, I'm not just advising on a piece of saying like, hey, I'm an attorney that understands the law here. I'm also an investor that says, this is actually how I build, and this is how the best investors in the country that work with me also build. You know, because, you know, I work with all the top guys in this industry, right? And we work on all the top areas of it. So, but the idea is to say, you know, I can help you bridge the gap and saying like where you're at to where you want to go, and what are the mechanical pieces you actually need to execute along the way, and how to save time from having to manage all of this extra, you know, machinery. So that way you can just focus on the really fun part of like, how do you actually make more money?
Scott, mm-hmm. What's the family office piece to this?
Yeah. So what we typically charge is, you know, you'll have here is it's like a package deal between like operating company, asset holding company, the anonymous trust, property transfers, et cetera. That typical, you know, amount that people are most of the time spending is somewhere around $7,000 to $9,000 total after you, if you got a full suite of everything that we do. The family office piece that we have in here is that's what allows us to be able to take care of all of the corporate compliance. So we take care of everything that happens with your companies to make
sure. Oh, like your corporate minutes and all that stuff.
Yeah. Everything. Yeah. And it's more than just minutes, right? I mean, you're talking about registered agent services. You're talking about, you know, meetings of the members, like everything that you would possibly need to do. What it also is essentially having, you know, us on call to be able to help you at no additional fee. Cause like nobody wants to call their attorney, cause they're like, hey, you know, it's $500 an hour for me to talk to that guy. Right. And he bills me every 5 minutes, you know? So we switched that model and we said, how about this? How about we charge you a ridiculous, low amount of money, you know, like $49 a month, and you get to call us as much as you want to. And so that way we can make sure that you're as educated as possible while you're building your wealth. So that way you're never going to make another misstep, because you always have somebody to reach out to you that's an expert in the field that can tell you exactly what you need to do next. So that's kind of where we're going with that. But what we decided to do as a special promotion for you guys is that we've really slashed down, I mean, a huge amount of what we typically would, what we typically charge. I mean, we reduced our operating company fee, which is what you would use for like a shell operating company to be your basically to, you know, collect your tents and be the landlord, hire contractors, otherwise engage in all of your business operations. You got to remove
yourself.
That's like
the top of the series, right? That's what that is.
The operating company is completely separate from the series. It's a standalone traditional LLC. The asset holding company is the series LLC.
Got it.
So you need one series LLC to hold all of your stuff, and you need a completely separate company that's going to do all of the business.
Got it.
Yeah, exactly. Because what you want to do is, like, a tenant complains or a contractor wants to sue you, whatever, they can sue your operating company that doesn't own anything. And it's like, boom, I don't care. I'll just start up a new operating company. Exactly. That's no big deal, right? And so the asset holding company will own everything and it'll manage nothing. The operating company manages everything and it owns nothing. So with that, you know, we're dropping the asset holding company price down from about 4,000 down to about 3,000. We're going to give, you know, the anonymous trust away for free. We're giving away two free property transfers, and we're giving 6 months of the family office away for free, you know, which is, it's about $3,000 off from our normal base pricing on that.
This is not attorney pricing here, man.
This is too cheap.
This is a good thing. Mad.
Yeah, this is too cheap.
This is Jake and Gino pricing here. Like, we might jump.
Well, that's why he's on the call, bro. Likeness attracts. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So.
Well, and that's what Gino, I mean, that's when we were talking about doing this, it was like, hey, you know, what can you do? This is the question they asked me. He's like, what can you do that's really going to come in and make it a no-brainer for people, to give people, like, what does top-level foundations look like? So that way everybody can afford it and everybody will just do it. You know, as I said, you know, that this is what we wanted to do for you guys as a special promotion. We don't really do this ever. I know there's a very limited window of time on that we're going to be holding a lot of this open for everybody, because, you know, we're actually here, we're not making much money, right? So we're just trying to be able to help out, you know, y'all's listeners and y'all's audience with that.